Girls love that. Chicks love the last shot opportunity. Somebody give me a napkin so I can wipe my mouth.
You know, Bob Ryan and Jeff Goodman had a very special guest on recently in their latest podcast episode. It was Brad Stevens, head coach Brad Stevens. Of course, he couldn't say too much about the free agents, had a lot to say about the rookies that were drafted, which we'll get into in a little bit. But what I wanted to bring up was the fact that, of course, Kemba Walker's name came up. And he's saying that it's a good chance that he's not going to be 100% for the start of the regular season. You know, good chance that he'll be limited. How concerned are you when it comes to Kemba?
I'm concerned coming from 1 year to the next year because your knees don't get better. They normally get worse.
Especially after a short offseason.
As you go in the short offseason.
Right.
So they don't get better. So that would really concern me about him. Because the thing that we've known for all these years, we're like, oh my God, when he was in Charlotte. He was an Iron Man, right? He missing like three.
Game.
He played like 8-9 years there, missed like three. He missed maybe 10 games.
Well, that's what scares me, Max.
So yeah, so I understand.
You know,
I
a lot
understand.
Of miles on there.
I understand
it's
that.
It's not a hoopty, but there's miles on there.
I understand that, but that's why maybe Teague is a real good pickup for you.
I like Teague.
I hate the fact that you don't have Wanamaker. I like Brad Wanamaker was just he was just solid.
Solid, yeah.
He's just solid.
Facilitator,
he wasn't going gonna hurt you at all when he got in the game.
Exactly.
Like things are gonna go well. And I've heard that he might go to Golden State.
Golden State
either.
Signed him. Oh, they agreed. They agreed. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
They agreed with terms.
Good place for him and his family. I've always liked.
I knew he'd end up somewhere.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
He showcased himself.
Yeah. And I've told that to young kids in this league. I had a friend one time who was trying. He was Chad Kinch, and I played with him in college. And it was just unfortunate what happened. He was a great player in college. Came from my school. And got drafted. He was going to get drafted early, but then he had a lot of problems his senior year. And then I ended up finding it was drug related and all that. And I remember we were in Cleveland, and he played with the Cavaliers. And he picked me up after a game one day, and he took me to the project and left me in the car for about 40 minutes.
Oh, shit.
40 minutes. I was like, oh no, man. You
what do you say?
Rookie year, dog.
I'll be right back.
Yeah, I'll be right back, man. I'm just running here real quick.
Real quick.
Yeah. That dude came out about 45 minutes, man. I was so pissed. Pissed at him because I told him, I said,
you just
dude,
sat there for what else was I going to do?
I went in my car. I was in the project.
You didn't go for a walk?
No, I was in the
car.
Sightseeing? And then it's like, and what pissed me off about it is then I told him about it. I said, when he got back in the car, I said, you have to get in a position in this league where you have to showcase your talents.
Mm.
You have to let people know that you can play. His rookie year, he barely played. So nobody, in the NBA, you haven't shown the skill set.
Right.
Like, Brad Wanamaker showed the skill set this year.
Mm-hmm.
He got a chance to show more of himself. So that's why Golden State said, yo, we'll take you.
Yeah.
And now with Clay out, that's going to be a pretty good situation for him.
I think not only because of the bubble, because he was balling out way before the bubble, but I think the bubble put you on a different plateau where I felt like people were really watching games.
Yeah, I mean, he played well.
He played well throughout.
He played well. Yeah. He's hitting big shots. He's making steals. Yeah, he played really well. So.
All right, let's talk about these rookies. What are we thinking here, Max? I'm liking Aaron Nesmith. I hear nothing but good things about Pritchard. Let's start with Nesmith, I guess. Sharpshooter. Shot over 50% last year. He was injured, but he managed to knock down 60 three-pointers in his sophomore year in 14 games.
Well, we're talking to, and now let's talk about something else, the fact that the three-point line isn't as far in college as it is in the pros.
Good point.
So, you know, that changes perspective. 1 foot away, 2 feet away changes your shooting percentage. But what I hear from Dan is he's one of the best shooters, and he could probably outshoot any guy on our team, on the Celtics team. So that's a good one. Pritchard, I'm a little bit more concerned because of his size.
Mm-hmm. Payne Pritchard, yeah. He's out of Oregon.
Tough kid.
4 year. Perk loves
4
him.
4 years.
Kendrick Perkins was raving about him the night of the draft.
He would say he's a tough kid, but you got to still look at his size.
Yeah.
He, you know, he reminds me of T.J. McConnell. yeah. who played for Philly yeah. was more just a piss. Wasn't like he was going to kick, but T.J. McConnell was in the right place, getting the rebound, knock down the jump
shot,
make a steal, high IQ.
Read the floor.
He gave Terry Rozier fits.
Yeah, he did.
He gave Terry Rozier fits. Yeah. I mean, he up on
Oh,
him,
man, that series in Philly, he didn't play well in Philly. Terry couldn't play well in Philly that series.
And that's what I look at Pritchard as being, but then I look at some of the other Celtic players out there. What are we thinking about? Romeo is going to be out for a while because of a leg, but are we thinking anybody else could be, you know, one of those things where you're going, you know, we think about point guards or, you know, I know that Williams is going to be good. I like Grant Williams. I think he's going to be a solid pro for a long time, but he's so undersized at different positions.
Yeah.
Will he find a natural position this year? Four shouldn't be his natural position.
Well, if you
Three should be his natural position.
If you think he's undersized, I didn't want to talk to you about Tremont Waters. I like the kid.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
He's really undersized.
Is Tremont Waters, is he, him and Pritchard, that's going to be a dogfight.
Yeah, yeah. They're fighting for that last spot.
That's going to be a dogfight because Tremont Waters, he's slick. He is slick. He can play the game at a high level.
I think the outside touch between the two might be the deal breaker, you know.
Yeah, Pritchard's.
Who can be more solid from behind the arc, I think. Maybe.
That might be true. And Pritchard does look like he's a little bit. And, yeah, he's just going to be gutty. Look like he's just going to be scratching and clawing for everything he got. Whereas you look at Tremont, he's more smooth.
Right.
He's more like herky jerky, get you up, look, crossover dribble.
I love his style.
He has a lot of style, but then
he's got like swag to it, some pizzazz to his dribble.
Both those guys are going to have to, but the thing about it, you have to defend. And his size, how tall is Pritchard? About 6'1"?
Yeah, 6'1", 6'2".
6'1", and you already got Kemba at 6'1".
Mm-hmm.
So what do you do with a 6'1 point guard? What do you do? Post him up?
Especially if Ben Simmons is on you.
Yeah. So, So I think it's some stuff that's going to be tough.
Yeah. No question. One thing to point out, too, also, I think is really interesting. The NBA has modified the rules for the G League. So, you know, the two-way contract, you can have two of those guys. Of course, Taco and Tremont had it last year. This year, because they're not even sure if there's going to be a G League season, NBA teams are permitted to have two of those two-way guys could be active for 50 games. So that's almost the entire season, Max. So you can get a lot of reps in with those guys, either one. Because in my opinion, one of those guys is going to go back on a two-way, whether it's Pritchard or Waters. Of course, looking way ahead here, if I had to, you know, call it, I think those two will be fighting for that spot.
Yeah. I agree.
Taco will probably be back on a two-way.
And I think that Pritchard is going to probably get a little bit of an edge with his ability to shoot the basketball from the outside. The thing I worry about him is he didn't look like he had great foot speed or great handle. Mm-hmm. You know, he scratched and clawed for everything he got.
Yeah, that's true.
And you're going to do that even more so when you are now in the NBA against quicker, faster, stronger, smarter guys.
Especially no summer league. All those months of practice of, you know, taking advantage of the practice facility.
Yeah.
All out the window. You have to use the next month as training camp.
Training camp is next week. So somebody's saying right after Thanksgiving, let's go to work.
It's like when I used to, you know, get back to high school ball right after Thanksgiving. But no, these guys have literally about a week and a half or so preseason, and that's it, man. They're going right into it.
And people wonder, so why did they do that? Why didn't they wait until after Martin Luther King's Day? It was about the money.
Course.
Because the NBA said, well, if you play after Martin Luther King's Day, you can play about maybe 60 games. Okay, let's take some of that salary away.
Mm-hmm.
And some of these primetime players are going, no. Let's do that. Let's go out. So we'll get a chance to see, you know. But supposedly we haven't seen, which is, again, weird. We haven't seen the schedule yet.
Mm.
There's no schedule. And you're less right now, you're less than a month away, and you haven't seen the schedule yet. But what you hear is that the teams now are going to essentially they're going to make sure that all the teams travel wise are going to try to play not the second night of a back-to-back, but they're going to try to play, like, you know, more so division teams around. Yeah. Some of the teams you're going to miss this year. Travel. You won't even see some of those teams you might play out west. But it's just going to be really weird. You think about, okay, the bubble was cool. But wouldn't it be weird to go into the Staples Center and have no fans there? Yeah. Wouldn't that be weird?
That would be weird.
Wouldn't that just be?
I think that's when you'll start hearing the awkward, you know, that everyone expected it's going to sound like at first, you know, because then you would hear like the echo and the squeaking more.
Yeah, you're talking, you know, a place like that that's holding 20,000.
Right.
Or Chicago Stadium, you know, 20,000.
Your voice is going to echo a bit.
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to find out how, you know, as a broadcaster, we're going to do it.
Yeah.
It's going to be just as interesting. We still haven't heard, but I assume that we're going to be doing all the games, but we're going to be doing all the home games here in Boston. So I assume that we're going to be in the stands. I assume. But I know that the away games, we're going to be in a studio someplace in Boston. So we won't see any of these road teams playing in any of those places. So bye-bye, Oklahoma City. Bye-bye, Milwaukee. Have a good time.
You're going to miss that hotel? You're going to miss that creepy hotel?
Yeah, miss that creepy hotel. And I'll miss all that fun we had in Milwaukee when I was having lunch with you.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that place, yeah.
At least the wings were good.
Yeah, okay.
This episode of Cedric Maxwell Podcast is brought to you by Masterclass. Right now, when you head to masterclass.com/CLNS, you'll get an annual membership, and they'll give you one for free just for listening to this podcast. You don't want to miss out on this opportunity.
No, you don't, really. I mean, Masterclass, you are learning so many things and exactly what they're saying. Master class, master teachers, could be somebody, if you have a poor golf swing, could be somebody teaching you who is a great golfer, teaching you about golf.
Absolutely. There's endless opportunities. And one of the classes that they offer is TV writing. And it's taught by Shonda Rhimes, the mastermind behind one of the greatest TV shows put together, Grey's Anatomy. Bunch of other movies. Her credentials are endless. And right now, if you head over to masterclass.com/CLNS, you can get a free membership, an annual membership, and sign up for her class or a dozen others.
Yeah, dozens. All kind of things that you want to do in your life. You want to be a great cook? You might have a chef that would be up there who would be teaching you how to cook maybe your Thanksgiving meal, which is coming up.
There you go.
That you get in this master class and they show you how to brine a turkey or do whatever people do with
whatever
a turkey.
Whatever side you like, they got
you.
Yeah,
right? So they, as you like to say, they got you.
Exactly.
They got you.
Explore at your own pace with over 90 classes that range from world-class instructors. Right now, head over to masterclass.com/CLNS. That's masterclass.com/CLNS.
Yeah, this is going to be, the year really is going to be defined in a crazy way for the NBA. And I think you look at the teams, you look at the movement, you know, is Harden going any place? Look what Brooklyn is doing. What do you think at all? If Harden, will you think Harden might move?
I think it might happen.
You do?
I do, yeah. But I don't think it'll happen right now because if you're Houston, what's the rush?
Yeah,
Houston. What's the rush? You almost have the luxury of this quick offseason.
Houston has
them. You can just say, hey, James, we got to get back to work. You know, we'll figure this out.
Houston has them for two more years, but the experiment there is gone. I mean, you sent D'Antoni away. He's gone. And it looks like Westbrook said, look, I don't want to play with Harden anymore.
Yeah.
And Harden said, I don't want to play here no more. So, and all that small ball they did, they've gotten rid of almost everybody. And frankly, they stunk to join up.
If you're Houston, you go into it and say, look, guys, let's give this one more crack at it. Midseason, we've seen this story before, right? Maybe not in Houston, but in other places. If they're, you know, doesn't look good, if they're arguing or fighting with each other, one of those guys will get traded. Well, maybe it's not James. Maybe it's not James, but one of those guys will get traded.
Well, look at this. You're saying James Harden right now to go to Brooklyn with Kyrie and Durant?
Can you see Kyrie signing off on that? I just can't see him signing off on that. This has Kevin Durant written all over it, right? Why would he sign off on that?
I don't know. I think that sometimes people want to have superpower teams. I mean, Kyrie already played with one.
This is personal, Max.
He played with one and he wasn't happy. Well, the bigger thing you're saying right now is those guys play with the ball. Two guys play with the ball.
Exactly.
Kyrie is ball dominant.
Right.
And Harden is ball dominant. Right. So what are you going to be doing if you're Kyrie or if you are Durant? Durant can score 20 in his sleep. He gets it all.
Well, there's that also, but Max, Kyrie doesn't want to play third fiddle. He will be the third option.
Kyrie's going to have the ball in his hand. He's the guy who's bringing it up. He's the guy on the break.
So what, James is spotting up?
Harden is spotting up or moving. Or
I feel like James has to bring the ball up.
I don't think Kyrie's not a get on the side and let me come off the pick.
That's what I'm saying. Nah, so how does it work?
I don't know.
You'd almost have to ask him to be the guy he was when he was the Kyrie. You don't have to ask Art Harden to be before he was the beard, the sixth man off the bench almost. Not literally, but you know what I mean? Remember how he used to just step in and just he wasn't hogging the ball.
Well, I'm going to tell you what. We'll look at a surprise team. Surprise team, I think right now that everybody's going to have to watch is going to have to be Phoenix.
Yo, Phoenix is going to be good.
Phoenix.
That's going to be a fun team to watch.
You think Phoenix, and if they can stay healthy, and you got Chris Paul there now being the facilitator.
Enthusiastic
Devin
Booker.
And you take the ball out of Booker's hand.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, I think, and Aiden is going to be so much better with Chris Paul.
I feel like months ago, they're probably thinking, yeah, we got enough. We can take care of the NBA. You look at that NBA Finals, you know Kyrie and Kevin Durant are like, or at least Kevin Durant's thinking to himself, do we got enough to beat these guys? Maybe we need a third one. I don't think Kyrie is excited about that. And I think the reason why James Harden is one, obviously, because, you know, he's not happy in Houston. You know, this would be an easier way. And you know, he could prove himself he's a champion. And two, if I'm Kevin Durant, I'm like, man, I'm going to show Russell Westbrook that I can team up with this dude. We're going to win. I'm going to get you a championship. I've been to the mountaintop. I want you to get there, too. You weren't able to do it with Westbrook. Come with me. I'll show you how it's done. Do it in the East Coast. We'll do it our way.
Everybody's been saying that Durant looks really good right now. Everybody's talking about how, you know, how well he's playing and what he can do. And just like, oh, okay. So he looks like he can easily get out of bed and get 20. So if Durant's playing that way, man, it's going to be interesting to see what happens. And like the whole thing is you talk about Armageddon. When you think about some of these teams, what they did. Look at Atlanta. Atlanta's improved in what they did. And Charlotte's gotten better. I didn't see that much from Miami. I'm a little surprised they didn't make some kind of splash.
They locked in their guys.
They locked in those guys. Yeah. But I'm still surprised they didn't.
Crowder went to Phoenix.
Yeah, I'm surprised they didn't do something a little different. If Crowder goes to Phoenix, and that makes Phoenix that much more dangerous.
Yeah, no question. Etwan Moore is heading that way too. Phoenix is going to be a fun team to watch, especially with Chris Paul. When you put Chris Paul in there, man, it's going to be interesting.
Phoenix is going to be a hell of a team to watch.
This episode of the Cedric Maxwell Podcast is brought to you by BetOnline.ag. The wait is finally over. Football is back. You might not be at the game this year, but you can still be in on the action at BetOnline.ag. BetOnline is going the extra mile to make sure you can get in on everything imaginable this season. From game spreads and totals to team, player, and coaching props, BetOnline gives you more options to wager than any other place online. You can get in on the action right now. The season opening bonuses is the best way to start you off wagering on win, division, and championship futures today. Head to betonline.ag and take advantage of all the great sign-up bonuses. That's betonline.ag. BetOnline, your online sportsbook experts.
But what about this Achilles injury? So you buying the hype a bit with this Kevin Durant? You know that he's going to be back to his normal springy self.
Well, the thing about it, he's a 7-footer. And he's not a guy that jumped over you. He would beat you with some quickness, but he was long enough just to shoot over you most of the time. And his handle, you know, way he handled the basketball, he always got separation. He'd get that fall-away jump shot. I was more like just in shock with seeing that what happened to Klay Thompson, though.
Oh, man, that was devastating.
Just the fact that, you know, here's a guy who worked his butt off to come back. And I guess, was he just working out?
Yeah, he was working out. I mean, people forget, these guys are back in the gym already, you know? So
working
he was
out,
working out with his team, working out with the Warriors. And it's too bad because I was looking forward to his emphatic comeback. I thought that he was going to, in some way, sort of outshine Steph in a way.
If you had Steph and then the pick that they got in Wiseman, man, that was, and then they got a couple of sleepers over there, you know, with guys that can maybe get it done. I thought they were going to be a team, you know, that Wiggins being there, they're a team that was going to be exciting about seeing them and how they matched up, you know. And their bigs didn't match up well, but when it comes to shooting, there's not a better shooting team in the NBA.
Right. So what do you think happens now? I mean, does Wiggins have to step up here? Do they have to make another move?
No, I don't think they're going to make another move. I think that Wiggins just has to step up. You force him into more of a prime role, but he's not. Nobody's Clay.
Right.
Nobody's Clay except possibly Steph. That, you know, you think about that 37 points he hit in the quarter. Let's say he dribbled the basketball 8 times to get 37.
Wow.
That's crazy.
That's insane.
That's crazy.
You know, it was interesting when that news dropped because it was right before the NBA draft. Everyone's waiting to see what sort of deal is going to go down. What are they going to do with the number 2 pick? Did a little part of you think that maybe the Celtics are going to come in there and try to swing a deal? Because that Marcus Smart thing sort of reared his ugly head again, so to speak.
I did an event with Marcus the other day, and we didn't get a chance to talk too much. It was just Vistaprint is the new sponsor for the Celtics, and he and I were doing a pep talk for the organization to the Vistaprint employees. And I was thinking about that with Marcus going, wow, Marcus Smart leaving, and I guess saying no. Because, again, he is, to me, the heart and soul of that team.
Right.
And, you know, when you talk about defense, you're talking about offense, talking about things he's able to do, dude is on point.
Yeah, no question.
And well, no question. Just go ahead and eat your soup. It's soup that I made for you now.
That was the shortest answer you ever got.
Like, damn, Max, keep going. That's why I gave you a short answer.
I look over, you staring at me. I'm like, well, keep going, man. You never.
Well, I just think, again, this whole league, the way it's set up now is just a lot of interest when it comes to it. You know, with LeBron, can they repeat? You know, Schroeder going now. Where's Rondo going to end up at?
Yeah, that's a good pick.
He turned down the money from the Clippers. Yeah. Where will Rondo end up? Is he going to, you know, he really set himself apart from, you know, a lot of the point guards in the league now. And that's the thing about the league. They cast you out. He did it. He was perfect for them. Now, Schroeder's more of a scorer. Whereas Rondo was more of a setup guy. And I think they need more of a setup guy than they need a scorer. But, you know, obviously Schroeder comes in. It's going to be interesting to see what happens.
What do you think his relationship was like with LeBron James? And I'm not trying to get controversial here, but something always felt there was a mutual respect, but there was almost like a, I don't know, like LeBron was going to give him way too much credit. He wasn't going to say, yeah, you know, Ray John really helped us.
No, he was on board with Rondo.
I think you could hear him
talking about Rondo, how he set him up. And for me, it helped LeBron out because it took the ball out of his hands and he didn't always have to be the playmaker. Mm. Like when Rondo was in, he was the playmaker. And that means that LeBron was roaming. He didn't have to set up Anthony Davis. He could go get in the spot. He didn't have to use his energy to bring the ball up. Rondo was that guy. So, I mean, the perfect complementary player for Anthony Davis and LeBron would have been Rajon Rondo. Yeah. Now, we'll see if the formula changes by getting Schroeder.
You think he just wanted, maybe he wanted more money, or maybe they just wanted, maybe they just wanted an upgrade? Maybe, I don't know.
I mean, I don't know. I don't, like, well, he wants to get paid. You know, you win a championship, you want to get paid. But I want to see now what's going to happen with how the Clippers. Are they going to bounce back?
Yeah.
Losing Doc Rivers? Montrezl Harrell is gone?
Do you hear the recent report surrounding Lou Williams?
Well, I haven't heard anything.
There's a report saying that they could be going their separate ways in light of what happened last year.
I can see that.
Lou might be ready to move on, you're saying.
I can see that, but he's still a primetime scorer.
Oh, no question.
For anybody who would come in, Lou Williams comes in, he can give you 20 in a heartbeat. So,
you know who else is interesting too? Because he's out there. No one's really said much about where he might go. Marcus Morris.
Marcus Morris, the more I hear about him, they say he's going back to the Lakers.
He's going to No, his brother's with the Lakers. You're talking about the Clippers.
Oh, you're talking about his brother.
Yeah, Markieff. They're saying he's going back. To me, maybe he's deciding between playing with his brother or playing with the Clippers. I don't know, but I'm not quite sure where he's going
to
end up.
It'd be interesting to see where he goes because
he go play with his brother. That'd be pretty cool.
He can help a team out because his brother passed him offensively. But he's still the better defender. Mm. when it comes to banging guys around. I still remember, you know, when Al Horford, he said, tripped him or whatever happened, and he wasn't supposed to come back and play. He hobbled out there on the first play of the game and whacked Al. He's like, no, don't worry about that. Don't worry about it. You hit me? Okay, we got you.
I got you on that.
Got you.
Yeah, he hit Luka too bad. He crossed the line on that one. But yeah, people talk about that a lot because that's the recent one. But yeah, he's a scrapper, man.
Will this year be Luka's year?
It could be. It could be the MVP season.
But they're saying Kristaps Porzingis is not going to be ready at the beginning of the year. He just had an operation.
Yeah, see, that's the thing, man. A lot of these teams are going to be at a disadvantage because of this quick turnaround.
Yeah, exactly. Because guys' bodies... Yeah, this is an odd tear your body up year. And then I wouldn't be surprised you got more guys injured this year because you said of the turnaround and because of the just the layoff.
Yeah, that's true. And I can't help but wonder which rookie is going to get screwed out of this.
Yeah, since you're talking about 20.
They need those reps, you know?
Yeah, but you're talking about 20 games, man. Mm-hmm. I mean, 20, not 20 games, but 2 months essentially from the last time. The Lakers probably won it.
Right. Yeah. 2 months. But then think about these college guys, man. These guys haven't been playing competitive ball since February.
If you haven't been playing competitive, that's your fault.
Well, you know what I mean.
If you haven't been out working in the gym.
You know what I mean. You know, like official, you know, I guess you can pick up his pick. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, if you ain't playing ball every day and you about to come in the NBA, then there's a problem.
That's true.
There are some issues right now.
And for those players who are G League bound, forget it, you know.
Well, let's see what happens. Like I said, if there's a G League, if there isn't, I mean, does Taco, is he going to be with you the whole time?
Right.
But again, what I keep saying is this year is going to be a mulligan. Mm-hmm. Because nobody, who's going to be excited about Taco coming in the game now? But the camera's going to be flashing, something like that? No, ain't nobody here.
It's just going to mean the game's over.
Whatever.
If Taco comes in, the game's over.
Keep it moving. Keep it moving. So, no.